Finding places to stay, apartments of friends that they are in right now. And so everyone is sort of trying to get some sort of stability in the city and try to begin to assess the situation, which is still very much ongoing. Tyler?
Well, that is exactly right. Of course, at the World Trade Center, among the offices there, those at least some installations of Morgan Stanley, Cantor Fitzgerald, Credit Suisse Group, Commerce Bank, and Deutsche Bank, as well as numerous state and federal offices, including those of the Customs Service, among others, and certainly the some of the trading in the commodities trading areas there. We've heard that Chairman Greenspan of the Federal Reserve is not at the Federal Reserve Building in Washington. We do not know exactly where he is or whether he is among the federal officials who have been taken to secure sites either in the Washington, D.C. area or elsewhere. We do know, as Alina Cho just said, that Speaker Hastert, who is in line in the line of succession to the presidency, has been taken to a secure location.
Third in line
To the White House, of course, the president and the vice president. And President Bush is was in Florida this morning, is evidently either on his way back or has, we do not know exactly where he is. The White House will not say, but they do say that the president is safe. Major League Baseball, as you may well have heard, canceling all of its games for tonight, and certainly there will be other such cancellations on this day. That the world changed forever.
Tyler, Martha had mentioned a contact number for, was it Morgan,
Morgan Stanley?
I want to pass along a phone number, and maybe the control room can listen along as I give that number. American Airlines has set up a hotline for family members. You'll recall that two American Airlines flights crashed into the World Trade Center buildings this morning. That number is 1-800-245-0999. Again, that number is 1-800-245-0999. Just to give you an idea of the sheer horror, one of the planes that went down, the United Airlines plane, one of them, the one that went down outside Pittsburgh, WPXI is reporting, and this was passed along to NBC News, that the 911 center received a phone call from the cell phone from that plane saying the plane was hijacked. The man talked about an explosion and a cloud of white smoke. Then the line went dead. That, of course, according, as I mentioned, to WPXI, a live report there. Another thing that we're just getting across the wires right now, and I may be stating the obvious, but according to the Associated Press, high-ranking city police official says the number of people killed or injured could be in the thousands. I had mentioned the World Trade Centers can hold about 50,000 people on any given workday. One city official had said more than likely around 10,000 people would be in the two buildings. I want to remind you as well that those first two planes that hit the North and South World Trade Center towers hit them about 18 minutes apart. I believe the North Tower was hit first, and so it is possible that many people in the South Tower were able to be evacuated, though of course at this early hour it's unclear how many.
Okay, we want to mention that we are joined on the phone right now by a gentleman named Brian Taylor, who is a market historian who has some expertise in the area of assessing what kind of effect these kind of tragedies, and clearly we may never have witnessed a tragedy of this magnitude in this country, and so it's difficult to make comparisons, but certainly during World War I and World War II, there were periods that that were devastating for the markets as well. Brian, are you there?
Yes, I am.
Give me your reaction to all of this morning.
Well, it's just horrible. All you can do is feel sorry for the people and the families who are involved in this and hope that we can prevent something like this from ever happening again.
In prior times, how have financial markets responded? What have they done? Obviously, there's not been an attack at the heart of the financial center in New York ever before.
No, there hasn't. But in similar crises such as World War I and World War II, initially the market would decline and then bounce back very quickly after people had taken into consideration what had happened. Now, during World War I, the markets were actually closed from August until December of 1914, although some trading did occur off the exchanges, and that led to them reopening it. Now, in London during World War I, the market was closed, as it was in other continental centers, and then in 1939, they did close the London market for a couple weeks before reopening. But in both cases, they tried to get things back to normal as quickly as they could, and they did do so.
You know, this morning, the New York Stock Exchange sort of initially, before it was determined what the explosion was, it looked like they were thinking about delaying the opening. And, of course, it would be the wish of, in the light of a terrorist attack, to try to maintain some order, to try to make it appear that that these markets would not be closed so easily, that it would take quite a blow to impact the U.S. financial markets, which is, you know, the global center of the financial markets. But clearly, the devastation and the sheer magnitude and the growing national nature of these attacks was more than anyone could expect to continue to trade during.
Oh, I think that's definitely true. I really don't think they had a choice in that matter. The only question is how quickly they can get the markets back open. I'm sure they'll try to do that as soon as they can.
Brian, we're going to ask you to stay on the line if you can. We want to bring in Ron Insana, who is with us from Midtown. And Ron, we are very happy to have you with us and to know that you are okay. Please tell us what your experience was this morning.
Well, I was heading down after we had learned of it about 9 o'clock or 8:55 this morning. I had called in to see if we should go down and aid the coverage, and I was on my way down. And we got fairly close to the building, and I ran into a cameraman from MSNBC, and we were trying to get across town past the World Trade Center to the West Side Highway, which is on the lower southwestern corner of Manhattan, to hook up with our colleagues from CNBC. And as we were going across one of the restricted zones, the building started to explode, I guess is the only way I could describe it. It was hard to tell if it was an actual explosion, but the building began to come down, and we ran, and I sprinted around a corner. John headed straight down the street, and it began to look like a scene out of Independence Day, with just blackness raining down everywhere. And as I cut around the corner, I ducked behind a car. And it got darker and darker. I got inside what was just a parked car and stayed there for several minutes. And the material continued to rain down. And it was literally pitch black, darker than night, for several minutes. And as it began to clear modestly, I made my way out and headed to a building, which was occupied by a few people. And there was a light that was shining from the inside. And so went in there, and there were a couple of police officers and a few other people. And we made our way out in what looked like, from all the movies that we've seen growing up, the aftermath of a nuclear explosion. There was gray debris over the entire area. The sky, the air around us was still filled with soot and ash and other debris. And we made our way to a police car, and the police picked up a couple of injured people as well as we made our way up the East Side Highway and eventually got to Midtown Manhattan. But it was truly a harrowing experience, and not nearly obviously as harrowing as others had suffered, but it was an unbelievable event in many ways, almost surreal.
How close were you, Ron, to the Trade Center when this happened? What did you hear, and what did your feet feel?
Fear, mostly. We heard that. I wouldn't call it an explosion. We did notice that the building began to blow at the top, and that material began to come down. And we just turned and ran as soon as we saw that. We were probably within a couple of blocks, maybe a block. It's hard to tell, but we were close to the base, but we were looking up at the top. And as we turned to run, material just began to fall. And like that scene in Independence Day where wind was just whipping down the street in the wake of an explosion, that's exactly what we experienced. And it went down the street, curved around corners, and blew with a fair degree of intensity, again, Tyler, until the sky was completely blown. Black.
Ron, I'm curious about what your thoughts are in terms of the global economic impact of all of this. You've watched these markets for many years, and this is a truly devastating event. What do you think where do we go from here?
Well, that's a tough question to ask. I believe, you know, the interesting, I shouldn't say interesting, but what these attacks obviously were designed to maximize impact, not just in terms of loss of life and political terms, but in economic terms as well. At the very least, one-third of this nation's financial transactions are routed through New York. This will disrupt the economy in a way I assume we can't fully appreciate yet, not to mention the massive rebuilding costs that will take place here to an extent in Washington and Pittsburgh and any other area that's been attacked so far. And it will create